So you know those tiny things in ZBrush that you'd sort of ignore, and one day you realize, wait, why didn't I know about this before? I've been using ZBrush for years and I still come across things like that. So this video is all about that. These tips are not as flashy, but they quietly made a big difference in the way that I approach certain things in ZBrush. Hey, if you're new around here, my name is Pablo Munoz. I'm a 3D concept artist and educator, and I help artists level up their skills in the 3D world, all in a way that is fun, clear, and actually doable. So let's jump into these 5 tricks in ZBrush that you probably didn't know about. All right, so here we are in ZBrush, and this is a character concept that I've been working on. So we're going to start with one that is probably one of my favorites, which is the interactive light. So I'm going to go ahead and turn off all the polypaint right now, and I'm also going to jump into the standard UI so that you can follow along. The other one is kind of like my custom UI, but this one is really, really cool tip because it allows you to interactively move the light around regardless of the material. So just to make things a little bit easier to see, I'm going to switch from the material that I use the most, which is this basic material, to the skin shade 4. And if I go ahead and let's position this character around here, and let's say that I want to do a render, what I can do is bring this interactive way of previewing the light. So all I need to do is move my mouse around, and then you will be able to change the lighting for the render. How cool is that? So again, this is something that is probably not as obvious. Like, you would expect this to be in the render palette somewhere in the render settings, or even in the light palette actually, right? But it's not in here. So you need to go to the ZBlogging palette, go to the miscellaneous utilities. I'm going to dock that to the right hand side, and it's called the interactive light. So as soon as you click on this button, you can start to move things around, and you see how that works. I'm going to press escape to get out. And if you want to invoke this command with a shortcut, you can actually do that. Again, I'm going to hover over this area, press the Control P. So this is the shortcut, Control P. And now I can start to move this around. So that's how I use it. And this is one of the best tricks I can show you. Again, it's not as flashy, but it does help. So if I want to move the light around, again, Control P, move my mouse, Control P, move the mouse again, and so on and so forth. So really, really handy stuff. All right, so for the second tip, it has to do with Dynamesh Resolution. I'm going to go ahead and jump back into this, and let's go ahead and isolate the head. Let's go into solo mode. So this is just the head. And currently, if I go to the geometry sub palette, we have 5 subdivision levels, and this has about 1 million polygons, right? So this one right here. So what I'll do to show you this technique, I'm going to duplicate this or clone it. So now I have just this bit, and let's go ahead and delete the subdivision level. And this is basically to show that you can work with Dynamesh, right? So if we open up the Dynamesh palette here, and by the way, if you're not familiar with Dynamesh, this is just a process that is very common and is mainly to sketch things out because you don't have to worry about the topology. So I'm going to click on Dynamesh. Right. So that created this, you know, weird low poly mesh based on the resolution that we set here, which is the 128. Right. So let's undo that. Let's increase the resolution a little bit, maybe to something around 600, and click on Dynamesh again. So we now have something a little bit better, but still we're missing details. Anyway, you could just keep doing this until you find something that you like. But here's the trick. You can actually, if I just undo that, you can actually find exactly the resolution that you need to match the level of details that you have in a mesh like this. All you need to do is click on the resolution, and without letting go of the click, just drag it towards the mesh. So you see, as I move around, it kind of like changes that resolution that is based on the amount of details that you have. So you'll have maybe like a higher number around this area where there is, let's say, more polygons than if I go down to the neck, for example, which is about 2,500 in resolution. So anyway, let's go for something pretty high, like 4,088. And I'm going to click on Dynamesh. All right. So now we have Dynamesh, and you see this is barely any difference. If I bring in the polyframe, you see this is actually Dynamesh. But we managed to capture most of those details. And, you know, it's still like halfway through what we had before, but you will be able to just click and drag and figure out the exact amount of resolution that you need to keep those details. So once again, all you have to do is click and drag in the resolution and hit Dynamesh. That's it. All right, so let's go ahead and move on to the third tip, which is actually one of my favorites, and it has to do with how to grow FiberMesh in a controlled way. So I'm going to go back into my full character here. And again, this is a very sketchy concept character. So you see like her hair, I have some curves here, I have some Sculptress Pro here. So it is just a bit messy, but again, it just works in the sense that you understand that that's the hair. But let's say if I want to give her a bit of a mohawk, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to select all the pieces of hair that I've been using. There we go. And I'm going to select the face. So the way that you grow FiberMesh, and you're probably familiar with this, I'm just going to go ahead and hold Control and click and drag to add some sort of mask like so. And of course, we can always click outside holding Control to invert the mask, and we can refine it. I'm also going to make sure that I have symmetry enabled like that. And let's do the same thing here at the back. I'm going to invert it, Control, And here's an extra tip for you in case you didn't know, you can hold Control and click on the mask to blur it. You can hold Control, click outside the mask to invert it, and then you can do the same thing. So I'm just blurring that mask a little bit. All right. So what you probably already know is that this is how FiberMesh works, right? You have a mask area, and then you go to FiberMesh right here, and you can click on Preview. Brilliant. So now we have a mohawk, and then we can just go ahead and stylize it. However, if you want to create something that has a little bit more character and you want to guide this fiber mesh with actual volume, you can do that. So here is the tip. I'm going to turn this off because that's not what I'm going to use. And I'm going to go to the morph target palette right here. And in this palette, I'm going to store a morph target that basically saves the current state of this model into ZBrush. And now I can go ahead and invert that and we can play around with the actual volume. So we're going to create kind of like a sculpted version of that mohawk. I'm going to bring in my gizmo, center to the unmask areas, push it up, and then maybe scale it on the Z-axis, rotate it a little bit. And we can also bring in the move brush. And again, just give it a bit of a shape. So let's say this is going to be our mohawk. You can also smooth things out. You can spend a lot more time working on this one. I just want to show you what the process might look like. All right, so that is pretty good. I'm going to go ahead and clear the mask now. And now, if you look at the morph target, we have this switch enabled. So we can click this to go between the non-mohawk, like the clean head, and the mohawk that we created. So this is great because now we can go to FiberMesh. We can click on Preview, and this is obviously is gonna make like a hairy head, but we can tell FiberMesh, hey, we wanna use that store morph target to guide where the FiberMesh grows. And to do that, we can go to the modifiers here, and let's scroll down to the bottom, and you'll see we have this switch called Morph Target Guided. So this only works and it's only available if you have stored that morph target. I'm gonna click on that one, and there we go. We now follow that that shape of the mohawk with the morph target. So that's pretty cool. And of course, you can tweak this a little bit. So in my case, I might want to get rid of the twist. I might also want to change the colors so that it's not, you know, it's a little bit better to visualize it here, at least in the recording. I don't want to have any gravity, so I'm going to reduce the gravity. So that's going to shoot straight up. And of course, you can go ahead and click Accept. And now this, I'm going to click here on no as well. And now this is a separate subtool that you can go ahead and tweak. Now, once you have this, you can bring in your grooming brushes. Let's say something like this groom hair toss. And that allows you to move things around and then stylize it, right? Now, this is a little bit too strong, so I'm going to undo that. I actually have a set of brushes that I customized. So if you want to try them out, I'm just going to put a link here as well. But I'm going to show you what they do. If I bring in my brushes, and these are my custom brushes, and I have a bunch of these different packs in here. I'm going to open up the fiber mesh, and I'm going to use something like this bender right here. So I'm going to double click on that. So now that I have this loaded, I'm going to go ahead and scale my brush size. And you see, this gives you a much more controlled way to approach the whole grooming process. So this is the reason why I customized this brush, and I made them available as well. So you will be able to do this type of stuff. Just to show you another one. Just for fun, I'm going to use the sharp clumper here. And this, if I reduce the intensity a little bit, it allows you to create these nice clumps of hair. So again, I'm just exaggerating things a little bit, but this is a very simple way that you can use to stylize, in this case, the mohawk, right? Again, there's a bunch of brushes that you can use, but the tip that I want to show you is that you can actually drive the growth of this fiber mesh based on a volume. So you can sculpt anything that you want, save it as a morph target, and use the tool that I just showed you, the feature that I showed you, the morph target guided. All right, so for the next tip, I'm gonna show you something that is absolutely essential, and sometimes it could be very hard to find or figure out. So let's say that I'm working on this concept, and I usually work on separate tools. So for example, you know, if I'm working on the shoulders or this kind of like vest, sci-fi vest, I might work on a separate tool. So I'm gonna click on clone. So now I have it in here and I can work on this one. And, you know, let's just enable polypaint so that you can see something different. Maybe I want to go ahead and change things a bit. So I'm going to use this Sharpie tool that is one of my custom brushes. And, you know, let's give it a different, maybe a complementary color here. All right. So I'll work on this, create a pattern. This is rubbish, but you get the idea. So I'm just going to create a pattern here, something that I could work with. And then once I finish, then I will just copy and paste that in my working file, which is this one, right? And I will do the same thing, let's say, with the belt. I will just clone that. And there we go. So now we have this in here, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the point here, or like the reason that I'm showing you this is precisely for the tip that I'm going to show you. But the reason I do that is because I end up with a bunch of tools, and this is just how I work. And you might do the same thing. But when you go ahead and save this file from the file and save as, it will save all of the tools. And let's say that you're getting to almost the final version. Let's say that I don't want to have this mohawk and I'm happy with the other type of hair that I had before. So let's just turn that on, right? And I want to save this one as my most recent file, and I want to get rid of all these things. Now, what you need to do is delete the other files that you don't need. So for example, if I select this one, I don't need this one. I already finished and I already put it into my working file. So all you need to do is on the tool that you selected, go down in the subtool palette, and then you click on delete all. So this will delete all the subtools. In this case, it's just one, and then it will remove this project and it will just change it with a default start. So I'm going to show you what happens. If we click on delete all, this is going to tell me it's an undoable operation. I'm going to click OK. And you'll see that it gets replaced with this PolyMesh 3D, which is the default one. But that belt that I had is actually gone. And you can just go ahead and go through all the subtools and click on delete all. And that's kind of like part of the tip. You can just delete everything and leave only the one that you have as your working file. However, to add to this tip, there is a simple way of doing it. If you go to the macro palette here, I'm going to dock that to the right-hand side, and I'm going to open up the macros. There is something that comes with ZBrush, one of the macros that comes with ZBrush, that allows you to automate this process. So here under the miscellaneous, you'll have this delete all. So if I click on this one, it will delete everything as I showed you before. However, we also have this delete unselected tools. So basically, because the one that I want to keep is the one I have selected, I can click on this button and I get this pop-up, and it's obviously telling me that this is what is going to happen. I'm going to click OK. And once it's finished, we're going to go ahead and check. And you'll see we don't have any tool. Even if I click on the tool thumbnail here, there is no other tool in there. So this is just a very quick way of cleaning up your file before you save it. So now when you go ahead and save this file, you'll have your character. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that this process of deleting all the other tools also get rid of the undo history. So you see, we don't have any undo history. But to be honest, when I save a file from here, I usually just leave this off, like the undo history. So it will also remove my history anyway. But it's something to keep in mind. So an absolutely fantastic tip that is kind of like quality of life here in ZBrush. All right, so for the next tip, I'm going to show you something that it might not be as useful for a lot of different scenarios, but I definitely find it quite interesting. So if I go ahead and select the head, let's say that we want to do that sort of mohawk that I did before. I will go ahead and control, click and drag to create that mask. And instead of refining things manually, there is a macro that comes with ZBrush. So this is the tip that allows you to round some corners in a mask like this. So in fact, I'm just going to go ahead and add another subdivision level. So we have 4 million polygons, so it's a little bit sharper. And let's do that. And I'm going to get closer here. And the macro that I'm talking about is called the Applied Round Corners to Mask. So if I click on this one, pay attention to what happened around the corners of this mask. Now I'm going to do it again, Apply Round Corners to Mask. And I'm going to keep doing it just to show you that the more that I do it, the more rounded those corners are going to be. And again, it might not be like the most useful tip, but if you're doing something like this, or even for hard surface details, you're going to be able to end up with a very clean mask that has the rounded corners, especially for panels and that sort of thing, is very, very handy. So in practical terms, this is something that you could use for this type of panels here that I use to extract things. So for example, if I go here and let's select this area, I'm going to hold control and create a mask like so. And then I can just go ahead and round the corners a few times. And this helps to maintain that sort of like visual language of, you know, we have panels, but everything has like rounded corners. I can invert that. And then we go to the deformation palette. Again, this is not part of the tip, just showing you a little bit of what the workflow would look like. And I'm going to go to inflate and also polish. All right, if I clear the mask, there we go. So we have a cleaner panel. So I thought this is a very interesting tip that is sometimes overlooked. Maybe you don't even know that that existed. And I wanted to share it with you. All right, and to wrap this up, I have a bonus tip which has to do with the ZBrush benchmark. So this is something that I also get asked quite a bit about, like what are the requirements for ZBrush, or if your computer can handle 10 million polygons and that sort of stuff. So if you want to figure out how ZBrush performs in your computer and with your current specs, all you have to do is go to the C plugin palette and go down to where it says C benchmark. So if you click on this one, it is a single button that allows you to perform a benchmark to figure out how fast ZBrush is on your computer. So I'm not going to do it because it takes a little while and it has to initialize things, but just know that it's in there. You can just click on this one and it will give you a score, and that basically tells you how good your computer specs are to handle ZBrush processes. All right, so hopefully these tips have been of help. And because I mentioned a few things that have to do with ZBrush masking, I do have a dedicated playlist in my channel where I cover a few features and a few tips dedicated to masking in ZBrush. So I'm gonna put a link here. So go ahead and check that out and let me know what you think. Cheers.